Welcome to On the Block. I'm Ed Wilkinson. And today we're going to be talking with Father Jeffrey Dillon, who is the pastor of Christ the King Parish in Springfield Gardens. There's a lot of construction going on around where we are, Father Jeff, but we're going to try to get through this, okay?
Okay.
Thanks for being with us today, Father Jeff.
Thank you for inviting me.
You have a very interesting story, because, and we've talked before about this, but before you were a priest, you were a police officer.
I was.
Tell us a little bit about that. Where were you a police officer?
Well, I worked for 8 years in the New York City Police Department. I worked in the 83 precinct, which used to be on Wilson and DeKalb. I worked in the 79 precinct on Gates and Throop. And I worked in the 24 precinct as a police officer that was on West 100th Street and Amsterdam Avenue.
So some of them were pretty tough neighborhoods. And in those days, that was a pretty turbulent time in the city, wasn't it?
During the 60s, I went on the police department in 1967. Certainly, it was a time that they had riots that were taking place. There were a lot of social upheaval. When I first went on, I was 17 years old. They were trying to get uniform officers out on the streets. And so they would welcome trainees into the police department who, when they turned 21, would attend the academy and become police officers themselves.
Mm-hmm. So did you work a street beat?
As a police officer in the 24 precinct, I walked a beat and then I rode in a radio car. I can still remember I was 24 Sector Charlie Frank.
Of course, you carried a gun at the time. Did you ever have to use your weapon in the line of duty?
I drew my weapon, but I never discharged my weapon in the line of duty, no.
What was the incident like when you had to draw your weapon? Do you remember?
There were a couple of times, men with guns, but it was on Broadway, a lot of people around, so you had to make a determination. Do I discharge the weapon, or can we resolve this in another way? And we were capable of resolving it in another way without discharging the weapon.
What was the policy of the police department? I mean, were you taught to shoot to kill, shoot to maim? Why would a police officer draw their gun?
Anytime you were taught and you were instructed and trained and over again, there was never a question that you were taught to shoot to maim or shoot to wound. Police officers aren't that good a shot. It's a reaction. If the circumstances warranted you to fire your weapon, you were shooting to stop, was the philosophy. If that resulted in a death, it resulted in a death. The philosophy at the time, because we were carrying 38 caliber weapons, they were the most non-lethal weapon that was out there, even more non-lethal than a 22 or a 25, certainly more non-lethal than a 45.
At 17, why did you become a cop?
Well, really, when I was a senior in high school, my father woke me up one day and said, they're having a test for police officers. You're taking the test. I said, really? I'm not interested in being a police officer. He said, you are now.
This was at Nazareth High School, right?
I did go to Nazareth High School, yes.
A lot of the unrest seems to be among young black men, you know, who claim that they're targeted by the police. You have a lot of dealings with young people in your parish. What do they say to you about police?
A lot of them say that they certainly are being targeted. They're being pulled over just because they're black, they feel. They're being pulled over without an explanation. One of the things that we try to do in the parish is try to connect the young people to the police, the local police. Mm-hmm. Educating police officers is the part of the job of the department to explain why you would be pulling somebody over. I think when people are understanding that if they fit the description of someone that they're searching for, then there's more of a sense that, well, this is justifiable. If they're just being pulled over without an explanation, feeling that they're being abused and taken advantage of, it creates a resentment. We have parents who encourage their young people to recognize that police are legitimate authority. Don't escalate the situation. If it's improper, we can certainly address that with the local precinct or the police department, but don't put yourself at risk by escalating a situation unnecessarily.
But you don't hear stories like that on the news every night. You know, the stories that seem to get to the headlines are the stories where something goes bad. Is that routine or is that just out of the ordinary?
Well, my sense is in this age of social media, we're hearing more of it because it's instantaneous news. And you're hearing it from around the country. So when it happens, everybody's in on it. My sense is that might be something that has to be addressed. I haven't worked in the police department for many decades, so I'm not quite sure where the educational training is and how they're dealing with that. Maybe that needs to be revisited, that they address that.
You said that in the parish you try to educate young people and the you know, between the police and the community. Are there certain things that you do to try to bring them together, or is this more of a dialogue that you've opened with them?
Well, it's a dialogue that we have with the young people, but we also invite the community relations officers. We're on the border of the 113 precinct and the 105. So inviting them in to speak to the young people, to get them to understand and to know who the police are, is an important part of the process of healing, so that they're familiar with whoever is serving their community and protecting them.
Did you ever feel your life was threatened at all as a police officer?
Yes.
What happened?
Well, people aiming guns at me, I thought that my life was threatened. Certainly in some family disputes that were violent, those could escalate very often out of control. So yes, there were some times.
Being a police officer is really a vocation, isn't it? I mean, it's not just another job, because if you approach it as another job, I don't think you're gonna last on the police force. Mm-hmm. How did you look at it, or did you enjoy being a police officer?
I enjoyed it. It was a great education. I worked with some tremendous individuals, and most police officers who enter the police department, they enter with the idea that they're going to have a dramatic impact for the good in the community. Mm-hmm. And so I worked with them, and I learned a great deal. And as a matter of fact, I considered it a great foundation for priesthood.
So there's got to be, you know, the way you're talking, that is a similarity between being a police officer and being a priest. Do you see some similarities in the two callings?
When people ask me that in the parish, a lot of people will say to me, what a dramatic change. And I say to them, no, both of them are in law enforcement. Both of them wear uniforms.
Different laws, though.
Yeah, different laws. I remember a police officer once saying this to me. As a police officer, our job is to stop evil. But he said, as a priest, your job is to transform evil. And it is true. Priests are called to deal with, on some levels, the evil and the difficulties that people are dealing with, and to help in the process of healing and transformation.
Do you maintain any relationships with the police officers today? Are you ever called upon, say, to say mass for police officers or different groups?
Periodically, I do say celebrate mass for different groups. I still stay in touch with, sadly, my partner who I work with. He passed away a number of years ago, but I still stay in touch with some of the men who I work with in the 2-4 precinct. Mm-hmm. Most of them are retired at this point.
How do the people in the parish react when they find out that you were a police officer? I mean, I guess that's commonly known, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. Most people in my parish say, Father, you walk like a cop. And I say, what does that mean? They say, well, you walk like you own the parish. I said, well, I'm the pastor. I do own the parish. I said, unless you want to take over the position. They appreciate, because I remember when I was first ordained, a woman said to me, you know what the problem with priests are? I said, no, but I'm sure you're going to inform me. She said, they don't know about real life. I said, ma'am, I probably know more about real life than you'll ever know. And then when she found out my background, she said, well, you're different. I think people appreciate from my background that I've seen another side of life, and I understand that, and I've dealt with that. And it certainly has helped me as a priest.
How do you bring the lessons that you learned as a police officer into your ministry as a priest?
I think, number one, you're dealing with people very often who are hurting. Generally, we used to say on the police department, you know, we don't get called when things are going well. We get called when things are not going well. And sometimes that's the case. It's not as often. Sometimes as a priest, you get called when things are going well and it's a celebration. But sometimes you're asked for advice and counsel when things are not going well. Mm-hmm. And so to deal with people as individuals, recognizing that they're unique individuals, that they each have their own wants, needs, and to respect that and understand that and appreciate who they are and what they're struggling with.
Well, you were called to be a police officer, apparently, by your father, and in a sense, there's a calling to become a priest, and you hear that from the father, too. We're gonna talk a little bit in our next segment about how you first began thinking about becoming a priest and some of the things that go into that decision, okay?
Very good.
So stay right where you are, and we'll be back with Father Jeffrey Dillon. Welcome back to On the Block, and we're here talking today with Father Jeffrey Dillon. And we were talking with you, Father, about your career as a police officer before you became a priest, and we want to talk about that decision to become a priest in a minute. But as a police officer, you know, you hear sometimes that police officers can be, they see a lot of the dark side of life, so to speak. They see a lot of crime, and sometimes that affects them personally, you know, in how they view life on the darker side. What are some of the things that you saw, and how did you think it affected you? You know, how did real life that you saw on the streets affect you?
Well, talking about in the 60s and 70s, certainly there were riots that were going on, violent crimes, murders, very severe accidents we might have to deal with on the Henry Hudson Parkway. Part of the reason that they talk about the work that they do amongst themselves incessantly. I remember once my partner's wife asked me, she said, "Phil never speaks to me about the job, but anytime I see you with him or with the other officers, you're constantly talking about the job." And I said, "Well, that's the way we process." I said, "Because we're talking with people who understand what we went through, and we don't share that outside the sort of the group that we're part of, because the people I speak to as other officers, they're going to appreciate and understand what I've gone through and what I've dealt with. Now, the fact is, I need to process it so that it doesn't, in essence, negatively impact how I'm doing the work that I'm doing."
You mentioned before it was a time of riots in the late 60s, and we're talking there about the Martin Luther King assassination, Robert Kennedy assassination. It was a turbulent time at that time. Were you in the middle of any of those riots? Were you on the street with your baton?
I was on the street with the Columbia riots. It was the time when we had the police shooting in the mosque up in Harlem. I wasn't on the street for the Martin Luther King riots. I was in the station house at that point. But there were other situations, yes, where I was on the street.
So when did you start thinking about becoming a priest? Where did that come from?
Well, I thought about becoming a priest before I was a police officer. Mm-hmm. I thought about it in high school, at Nazareth High School. At that time, when I was at Nazareth High School, I thought to myself, well, this is something that seems to be attractive to me. And I went to the chaplain at the time, Father Variali was the chaplain. And he said, "Well, you need to have a college degree." And I thought to myself, well, that's a sign that God doesn't want me to be a priest. Because once I graduate from Nazareth High School, I think my academic career is finished. So I put that off for a while. And as a matter of fact, it wasn't until after I was on the police department, the local priest in my parish, who had heard that I had thought about becoming a priest, said, "I heard you were thinking about that." I said, "Well, they're looking for college degrees." And I said, "I don't know if I'm college material."
Well, what changed your mind?
The more I thought about it at that time in my life, I thought, well, this is my dream. And the dream comes from, I'm assuming it comes from God. If God placed it in my heart, I need to give this a chance. And so I inquired about the seminary, and I was told that I could go to Pope John the 23rd Seminary, that they would take my life experience, that I wouldn't have to get a college degree. They would take my life experience and then I would study theology. And when I went to interview at that seminary, after taking IQ tests and profile tests and interviews, they said, "Well, you're still young enough to get a college degree," which wasn't what I wanted to hear. But they said, "We would like you to go back to college for 1 year, or to go to college for 1 year, and then we'll welcome you into Pope John the 23rd Seminary." So I inquired at the local college, Cathedral College, the Immaculate Conception in Douglas and Queens, and they welcomed me the following week, which was interesting because you can't leave the police department on that short of notice. I was told that on a Monday, and when I went in on Tuesday, I said, "Well, I'm quitting the police department to go to the seminary." They said, "No, you're not." I said, "What do you mean?" I said, "You can't just leave the police department. You have to give us 30 days notice so that we can do a background check to see, are you trying to get out of something?" But my captain was a good Catholic, and so he covered for me, and I had vacation time. And so I went to the seminary in Douglaston, but I was on the roll call in the 2-4 precinct for the first month.
Well, what did your partner think about it? Did he think you were crazy?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And not only my partner, I remember telling my father, it was December 1974, that I was thinking of entering the seminary. My father was a lawyer for the Corporation Council of Kings County. Good Catholic, but he said this, "That's the stupidest idea I ever heard in my life." He said, "You put 20 years on the police department, you get a pension, and then throw your life away." My mother said, "I don't think you understand what he's trying to say." He said, "I'm not interested in understanding what he's trying to say." Now, when I tell that story, people say, "Oh, that's terrible that he said that." I said, "No, he was being very loving. He wanted to make sure his son was secure financially."
I was going to ask you, what do you think what was his thinking there?
Well, my father, he grew up during the Depression time, so he wanted to make sure all of his children were secure financially, that they didn't have worries. And I was glad that I told him, because 2 weeks later he passed away.
Ooh.
So yeah. He never saw me as a priest and never saw me leave the police department and enter the seminary.
And your mother, though, was supportive of the idea?
She was supportive. Sadly, the next month, January of 75, I entered the seminary, and 2 weeks later she was diagnosed with some stomach cancer, and she passed away 9 months after that.
That must have been a personal burden for you.
It was a difficult time. And certainly the transition from the police department to try, because I thought to myself, well, I'm putting all my eggs in one basket. I'm giving up the police department, the career in the police department, and entering this sight unseen. And I thought to myself, well, I didn't do so well in high school. Wait till I see what I do in college. Mm-hmm. But then also losing both of my parents was a difficult time.
What was the toughest thing about going into the college? That was a place where you lived, right?
Yes.
You moved in there and you lived with a bunch of younger men, actually, right?
Right.
These are guys that are younger than you are.
Yes, and it wasn't that much younger, but I entered the police department at 17. And so in my own life, I consider that my adolescence, I was demanded to act a certain way and respond a certain way. When I went to Cathedral College, we were talking about college-age children, but young men, and they acted like college-age young men. And so I would watch and look around at some of the behavior and think to myself, oh my God, as a police officer, I probably would have responded differently to this behavior. Mm-hmm. I'm one of them. I look at it and just shake my head.
And how were the academics? How did you find them?
Well, it was amazing because for this, I thought, this is an act of God. I remember the academic dean came to me and he said, you know, we accepted you sight unseen. And he said, you took the college boards, didn't you? I said, yes. He said, do you remember what you got? And I said, yes, 700. So he said, wow, what did you get on the other one? I said, no, that was it added up. So he said to me, that's impossible. You're an honor student in the classes that you're taking here. I said, well, it must be God. I said, because it wasn't my academic experience that I was ever an honor student.
Well, did you think that maybe you were a more mature person at that point and the studies really meant a little bit more to you?
Well, they certainly did. For my history, and I remember a number of people had this experience. When I was in grammar school in the 50s, I remember being moved up from the first grade to the third grade. And I have a brother who's older than me. He was in the fourth grade. And from the third grade on, the sisters would always say this, your brother gets hundreds. How come you don't get hundreds? And I thought it was pretty obvious I'm not my brother. But from that time, and even through Nazareth High School, which I followed him through Nazareth High School, I thought, this is an unwinnable situation because I'm never going to top my brother. So I didn't take it as seriously as I probably could have, mm-hmm. and I probably was capable of doing.
So did you have to spend 4 years in college then to get this college degree that you really didn't want?
No, at the time, Monsignor Gradalone, who was the rector of the seminary, because before that I had been promised admission to Pope John the 23rd after 1 year, he said to me, if you want, you can complete your college degree. So I said, well, if I decide to complete it, I said, I'd like to do it as quickly as possible. And so I finished the 4-year degree in 2.5 years by going during the summer to St. John's University and also carrying a full load of 18 credits each semester.
Well, we're going to talk a little bit more about the next big step, which is major seminary and then priesthood. We're talking with Father Jeffrey Dillon today, and we're on the block here. We'll be right back, so stay with us. Back to On the Block. I'm Ed. This is Father Jeff Dillon. And we've been talking about your life as a police officer and then your decision to get into the priesthood and go to the seminary. The one thing I just want to ask before we talk about priesthood itself is that the fraternity that you had as a police officer, did you feel that same kind of fraternity then with the men that you lived with in the major seminary as you approached priesthood?
In some ways it's different because when you're a police officer, you're dealing with very traumatic experiences that bring people together. I would think it's similar to the military, that when you're dealing with traumatic experiences that bind people together because you're relying on one another to be supportive of one another, you're relying on one another to stay alive in some ways. In the major seminary, it's not as intense that way. There certainly is a supportive network, people with similar interests, You know, there's groups that love sports. There were others that were, you know, I was part of the choir in the seminary.
What group did you fall into?
Well, I would be sports, but I would be in the choir. So there were different interests and different things that people would be engaged in.
You have had an interesting ministry, mostly in black parishes, we said here in Eastern Queens. A little break there for a while when you took care of senior priests in the diocese. The work that you're doing today out in Christ the King in Springfield Gardens, and you have a number of actually parishes or churches that respond to you. Tell us what your role is out there in Springfield Gardens.
Well, I'm the administrator at Christ the King. I'm also the administrator at St. Mary Magdalene Parish. I've also helped out as administrator for a little while at St. Clement Pope Parish in South Ozone Park. Primarily, my role, I see, is to make sure that there is Catholic education opportunities for the children, but also for the adults. I see very important in each parish having a social justice ministry, that it responds and educates people about the social justice issues of our time. I also have a social work degree, so I do some counseling. But also beyond that, as a parish community, we are connected to the local Church of the Nazarene, and we are part of the membership of Faith in New York, which is a group of not only Christian churches, Muslim mosques, Jewish synagogues, other churches that come together to address social issues in the city of New York. Faith in New York, we originally started in Queens, but it moved to Brooklyn, Manhattan, the Bronx. So it's addressing issues in the city.
And you get involved in a lot more things than just sacramental preparation and sacramental ministry. I mean, your pastoral ministry is kind of like all over the place out there.
Generally, I find that in our communities, the minister or the priest, he has to deal with other things. So we deal with transitions into nursing homes. In the 2000s, we had a situation, ExxonMobil, the gas station on the corner, was leaking gas under the property. And so we had to go to Wall Street to get a law firm to litigate the case. We had to sue ExxonMobil as a result of the damage that they caused, not only to our property, but to the neighboring property. Also to address that as a social justice issue, that a utility company should not be poisoning the land where people are living. And so, yes, it becomes broader. Each day has a different thing that you address.
Well, one of the things that you had to address a couple of years ago was a major fire in one of those churches that you were administrating for, St. Mary Magdalene.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that and what has happened in the interim.
6 years ago, St. Mary Magdalene burned down as a result of an electrical fire. In the beginning, because it devastated the church, there was some question whether or not we would rebuild, whether or not people should be encouraged to go to neighboring parishes. An assessment was made that it was a vibrant community, and so along with the diocese, we decided to rebuild. The bishop's desire was that the original church was a country church. He wanted the new church twice as big. Hmm. And so we are just completing the new church, which is scheduled to be dedicated. People are very excited about that it's a vibrant community. I think one of the things that we've always encouraged people to understand is they are the church, mm-hmm. not the building. The
bishop wants a bigger church. You have enough people to fill that bigger church?
We do have enough people to fill that church. Mm-hmm. Our question now is, do we have enough people to pay for that church?
Okay. You said you enjoyed being a cop. Do you enjoy being a priest?
I love being a priest. I still have friends in the police department. Any regrets? And I said, no, this was the correct choice.
What's the greatest satisfaction that you find in being a priest?
I would say the greatest satisfaction is seeing people live up to their fullest potential and appreciating God in their life.
Mm-hmm. What's the toughest thing about being a priest? You know, you sometimes say, well, it must be a very lonely life. You know, priests can't get married. They live by themselves. Is it a difficult life in some aspects?
In that sense, I think that each individual is going to approach it according to their own personality. I've lived alone since the 80s as a priest, and so I've recognized if there wasn't going to be a supportive community in the rectory, I needed to put that in place, that there would be a supportive community that I would have with other priests, with lay people, outside of the rectory. So it's worked for me. I can understand there are some who might find it difficult. And I've heard this complaint from priests. There's a lot of administration. Well, that's, roofs and boilers and buildings. I think to myself, that's part of the job. If I don't have a church to welcome people, it's going to be hard to minister to them. You know, in my life as a priest, When I began as a deacon down in Coney Island, and I found that there was a need for mental health services. So I got a degree in counseling to help. When I was at St. Clement Pope, we opened a homeless shelter. The pastor at the time, Father Vetter, he said, "Why don't we have a shelter?" I said, "Well, we can't just have a shelter." I went out and I got a social work degree. When I was the vicar for senior priest, ministering to seniors, I got a degree in senior mental health. Mm-hmm. So I think that in any of those areas, I didn't start out knowing about boilers, mm-hmm. but you have to learn. Mm-hmm. I didn't start out knowing about roofs, but mm-hmm. you have to learn because it's part of the job.
Well, when you're not saying mass and you're not fixing boilers, what do you do in your free time, like to have fun and to relax and unwind?
I like to fish. I have a friend of mine who years ago, as a birthday present, bought me a fishing pole and some fishing gear, and I was up in the Poconos, and so I thought to myself, so what do I do with this? But I learned to enjoy it, I love to fish. There's nothing like being on the water at, say, 5:30 in the morning with the sun coming up, fishing, and I've learned this. A lot of people think it's in catching. It's not in the catching. It's in being there, enjoying that, and being rejuvenated. And I'm a catch and release fisherman, so I have an agreement with the fish that they'll, if they bite the lure, I'll let them go.
Last question is, young man comes to you in the parish and says, "I'm thinking about becoming a priest." What do you say to them?
I say to them, "What about priesthood is attractive to you? Where are you at in terms of your relationship with God? How strong is that? How are you putting in place a supportive network to encourage that?" And then my responsibility is also to direct them to the vocation director and the other members of the diocese who are in the supportive network of helping that individual to sort of develop that vocation.
Great. Thanks so much, Father Jeff Dillon. We've had a great discussion here today.
Thank you.
And I hope you've enjoyed our discussion with Father Jeff Dillon. Well, you've been watching On the Block. I'm Ed Wilkinson. Thanks so much for being with us, and we'll see you next time.